Blackstone Publishing presents Wild Rescues, a paramedic's extreme adventures in Yosemite, Yellowstone, and Grand Teton by Kevin Grange. This book is read by Timothy Andrés Pabon. For the park rangers, past, present, and those in the future, who keep America's best idea alive. Author's note. In this memoir, I have changed the identifying details of patients, and in some cases, the exact location of the emergencies described to protect individuals' privacy. However, the nature of the emergency calls and the treatments I provided have not been altered. In addition, out of respect for the privacy of National Park Service personnel, and since many work in law enforcement and are involved in active investigations, I have changed their names and identifying details, and in some cases have created composites of their personalities. I did not change the names of the medical directors with whom I have worked, since they are well-known public figures, and I thought it important to honor their great work and contributions to emergency medicine within our national parks. To date, I've worked on a seasonal basis at Yellowstone, Yosemite, and Grand Teton National Parks. While pinballing back and forth is a great adventure for the seasonal employee, it can be difficult to follow for a reader. To account for this, I have condensed the time I spent at these parks into separate sections in the book and organized the emergencies according to call type and sometimes generalized dates, times, and order of events. I have also included some 911 calls that I responded to with Jackson Hole Fire EMS in the national forests surrounding Grand Teton, since they share the same wild, remote nature. Lastly, this book represents my own personal views and does not represent the views of the U.S. Department of the Interior or National Park Service. The events and conversations depicted here are based on my own recollection, and I've worked hard to ensure the details are accurate. I take full responsibility for any inaccuracies. My hope is for Wild Rescues to provide readers with a sense of the rigorous job that remote and rural first responders endure, and to increase awareness and appreciation for our national parks and the dedicated people who work there. If this book kindles your interest in the National Park Service, I encourage you to explore working in a national park as either a volunteer or paid employee. Above all, my hope is for Wild Rescues to inspire you to enjoy our national parks with your family and friends. Get outside and never stop exploring our vast, beautiful planet. KG. Prologue. Return of Spontaneous Circulation. If a trail is to be blazed, send a ranger. If an animal is floundering in the snow, send a ranger. If a bear is in a hotel, send a ranger. If a fire threatens a forest, send a ranger. And if someone needs to be saved, send a ranger. Stephen T. Mather, First Director of the National Park Service. The first time I helped bring back someone from a cardiac arrest in a national park occurred at 4:39 p.m. on Saturday, April 4, 2015. An hour earlier, Irwin Barrett, a 56-year-old cattle farmer from Wisconsin, was having a heavenly day. It was the first time he'd visited Yosemite, and as he drove into the valley with his wife, Rebecca, and their 28-year-old son, Jake, he couldn't get over the magnificent waterfalls and the granite monoliths of El Capitan and Half Dome rising above the fog-blanketed forests. After lunch, Irwin and his family decided to hike around the rocks of Lower Yosemite Falls, hoping for a better view of America's tallest waterfall, which tumbles 320 feet from the high crags in two successive steps. Irwin scrambled to the top of a large boulder, but as he stood up, something about the dizzying scale of the granite cliffs and the sound of water crashing in all directions threw him off balance. Jake attempted to catch his father, but instead they both fell 10 feet into the shallow water and boulders below. When the call came in, I was scarfing down a turkey wrap in the EMS office at the Yosemite Medical Clinic. I'd missed lunch when I went out on a search and rescue, SAR mission, up the Mist Trail earlier that day for an elderly woman who'd fainted. Ambulance 3, the dispatcher called over the radio. Please respond to the rocks beneath Lower Yosemite Falls for a report of two people who fell off a boulder. Standing, I squeezed the last bite of my sandwich into my mouth and hurried to the ambulance. Luke Cohen, a park law enforcement ranger, arrived on the scene first. If you were ever ill or injured in a remote place like Yosemite, Mount Rainier, or Zion, Luke was the person you wanted responding. He perfectly embodied an all-hazards responder and was everything I aspired to be. Along with being a park ranger and paramedic, he was also highly trained in structure fire, wildland fire, search and rescue, and hazardous material emergencies, and he was certified in tactical EMS, high-angle rope, and swift water rescue. Like some kind of special ops soldier, he was able to operate in all environments, earth, air, and water, and was just as comfortable dangling out of a helicopter performing a short-haul rescue on the side of El Capitan as he was plucking a drowning victim from the Merced River's swift current. Best of all, Luke was a calm and consummate professional, no matter what the emergency. But when he gave his scene size up over the radio that afternoon, his voice sounded panicked. "I have two patients," he said, struggling to catch his breath. "One green tag, one red." Color-coding patients as green, yellow, red, or black tag was a way to quickly triage or sort patients in a multiple casualty incident. A green tag meant the patient could walk and had minor wounds. A yellow patient was more severely injured, and a red tag meant the victim had critical, life-threatening injuries. A black tag meant call the coroner. "Ambulance 3 copies update," I replied, arriving on scene. Noah, my partner on the ambulance that afternoon, and I parked at the trailhead, grabbed our spinal immobilization equipment and basic life support bag, which had oxygen, splinting equipment, bandages, and curved plastic devices known as airway adjuncts, so patients didn't choke on their own tongues, and raced up through the boulders and shallow water. As we approached, I spotted the telltale signs of an emergency, a body lying supine, surrounded by worried bystanders who appeared helpless. Fortunately for the patient, though, Luke was also on scene. "This is Irwin," Luke announced as we arrived, gesturing to an overweight man in jeans and a red Wisconsin Badgers football shirt. "About 15 minutes ago, he fell into the water from approximately 10 feet from that boulder just behind us. Family states he had a loss of consciousness lasting approximately 1 minute. They, along with a few bystanders, helped drag him from the shallow water, and now he's alert but says he can't move or feel his lower extremities. I also noticed he's growing increasingly lethargic."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.